ghost. No, because ghosts are not real.
It is.
It is not wrong.
It is.
It's not.
Like when you die, you become ghost.
Do you really?
No, I don't do that.
Yeah, sorry, wrong.
But this show a lot of picture and video.
I believe in something else.
Yeah, no, not the ghost business, sorry. Anyways, you told me, like 2 months ago, you have no religion, and now all of a sudden you're believing in ghosts?
Yeah. Ghosts, aliens.
You believe in ghosts and aliens?
Yeah, aliens happen. It's have aliens.
Some students make me believe that aliens are with us at the moment, in disguise. Yeah.
Yeah. What about vampires?
Vampires.
True. I'm sure it's have a history of
I don't know if we're on.
It is!
Is it real?
Yeah, it's European. That vampire.
You like Twilight? I knew it. What you mean is you want vampires to be real.
It is! There's a guy who believes that green blood will survive.
If you say so. If you say so.
What about demons?
Demons?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, they're definitely real now. I know a couple.
Why?
What?
Demons. Why do you know it's real?
Oh, because I know some personally.
Really?
No.
What about angel?
Angel?
Yeah.
Oh goodness, I don't know for one.
Well, you don't believe.
I didn't say that. I said I don't know.
I'm sure I didn't.
So to recap, you believe in ghosts, vampires, demons, angels, and aliens.
A lot of mystery things.
Indeed, a lot of mystery things.
Like Bigfoot.
Oh, you believe in Bigfoot as well? Loch Ness Monster? What else have we got?
Dragons?
Yes. Dragons? Oh, yes. Yes, Santa Claus?
Unicorns
yeah, are real.
Dinosaurs?
No, I think they were real ones. Okay. Where did we stop? Lenz's Law, wasn't it? Yeah, this is where we start, wasn't it? Yeah? Okay. Next. So far we know that a moving magnetic field will cause a current to flow in a conductor. And what does Lenz's Law tell us? What can we know from Lenz's Law? What does Lenz's Law tell us, if you look at your notes, if you forgot? Come on, guys, wakey wakey. Yeah, so what can you know from this law? You can know the direction of the current. Yeah. Well, it kind of would also be useful to know the voltage of the current, wouldn't it? Not just the direction, but how much you have, right? So that's the second law, which is called Faraday's Law. We want to know the voltage. Faraday gives us the law. Faraday's law says that the voltage, the EMF, is equal to minus N times the change in the flux over the time. Now please note, this minus is just Lenz's law. The minus is telling us that the flow is opposite to the change in the field. And the N is the number of loops. This is Faraday's law. What does delta flux mean here?
The
change in the flux over the time. So if you want to make a big voltage, what would you need to do to the flux?
The
full sentence, please. Half right.
You want to make a
voltage big.
Bigger.
Yeah.
Increase the flux.
Yes. So increase the flux and decrease the time means what? Put those two together. What does that mean? Increase the flux, decrease the time.
Increase the number of loops.
Or increase the number of loops, yes. What does increase the flux and decrease the time? Put that together. That means you're doing what?
Increase
the
what? Huh? Okay, you're not getting it. Sorry. Increase the flux and decrease the time means you change the flux quicker. Yes? Because if you make more flux in less time, then that means you're changing it quicker, faster. Huh? So that could mean you move the magnet faster. Yeah? Move the magnet fast can make it have a bigger voltage. Move the magnet slowly, you have less voltage. Yeah? Is that okay?
Wait, so the flux is the movement of the magnet.
No, don't make it come down there. We did what flux is. What's flux?
Yes?
Field lines.
Yeah.
This is the change in the flux, is the movement of the magnet. We'll look at examples of what that means in a moment. Can I continue? Yes? Continuing. So, if we move a magnetic field around a conductor, or a conductor around a field, then we can use this to generate power. Question? Yes, of course we can. Behold the AC generator. This looks familiar, doesn't it? What does it look like?
No.
It looks like the DC motor. It is a little different. This time, you turn the wheel at the back. You turn the wheel at the back.
Manually.
And by turning this, you are turning the conductor. Now, think about this logically for a minute. Let's say this is the conductor and this is the magnet. So if I move the magnet over the conductor, what happens here? What do I get? I get a current. Now, this is the same as doing this. Can you see that? I mean, it's the same thing. You're changing the magnet over the conductor, or you're changing the conductor under the magnet. It's the same effect. So which do you think is easier to move, the conductor or the magnet, in this picture? Well, the conductor. So what you do is you turn the conductor, which is the same as turning the magnet. And we'll get a voltage. And the voltage will come out here. Now, here's another difference. Can you see here? You have two carbon rings again with the brushes and a resistor here. So for example, this could be a light bulb. Now, before we actually get onto that, this is how power is made in the power plant. So for example, what could turn this wheel to make a voltage come out here? What could you do to make the wheel turn? Wind, very good. So you could have the wind turning it, yes? Yeah, but how would solar make the wheel? Like, keep it simple. Keep it simple. Huh? You use an electric motor to power an electric generator. So where does the motor get the electricity from? Oh, from the generator, obviously. No, give me something you would like to turn into electricity. So, as Yusuf said, you could have a wind turbine, wind turning.
Water,
yep. At a waterfall. What else?
Fuel.
Huh?
Fuel.
Yeah, but no, you need to you can't just pour petrol on it and it starts to turn. And tell me how to make it turn to make power.
Gas.
Yeah, but again, you can't just pour gas onto it. Like, what do most power plants use? No, no, in Ireland, we'll say. Use coal.
Oh, yeah.
So how can you use coal to turn a wheel? Yeah, but how can you use heat to turn a wheel? Yeah. The coal can heat the water. The water can become steam. And the steam can push the wheel around. Okay? This is how most power plants work. You can use coal, oil, gas. But what would be better to use? Water, wind, coal, oil. You know this. You know this. No, not this one.
What would be the best to use?
Huh?
Of all the country. When? Like the most efficient or environmentally?
They each have positives and negatives.
Yeah.
It's not a simple matter of one is best for all. In real life, you'll need a mixture for your country. You'll need some power plants that use coal. You will need some power plants that use wind. It's not right to say all your power plants should be coal. Guys, why would it be bad if all your power plants used wind? Yeah, well, let's just take Ireland as an example.
Yeah,
what about in Ireland? Well, this is the same. Maybe some days there isn't a wind blowing. Okay.
And then
there's no power. So why is it bad then to have all the power plants using coal?
Environment.
No, don't even care about the environment. Pretend you're Donald Trump for a moment and you don't care about the environment.
What happens if the coal runs out?
Yeah, if the coal runs out. But not even that, because that's long-term thinking. And we're imagining we're Donald Trump and we don't think 50 years into the future. So let's not think about that. What's another reason? And is it though? It's not really. Coal is cheap. Coal is cheap. No, it's cheap. It's cheap.
No,
we're Donald Trump. We don't care about the environment. Screw the environment.
Yeah, but when we can do it again.
Huh? So the reason you wouldn't want to use coal is because in a place like Ireland,
you wouldn't want to use coal?
Yeah.
You wouldn't want to use coal for all of them?
For all of them, exclusively. The reason we wouldn't want to use coal for all our power plants is because we don't have coal in Ireland, naturally, so we'd have to import it. Mm. Now, sure, there might be enough coal to import from China or Australia or wherever, but you can't always guarantee you can get the supply. Just like you can't guarantee you can always get wind. That's why you want a mix. If the day isn't windy, you can use the coal. If there's a problem in your coal supply, because maybe a country's at war, or there was a shipping accident, then you can use wind. So you really want a mix of everything. You want some solar, some wind, some coal, some oil, and maybe even some nuclear. Okay?
Hmm?
And water, yeah. So, for example, Arab countries have a similar problem to Ireland in that they rely too heavily on fossil fuels, really. But, you know, even if you go to France, France relies too heavily on nuclear.
They rely on solar too.
I know, but proportion, percentage. In France, they rely too much on nuclear. Where do they get their nuclear fuel from? From Australia. What if Australia says, screw you, France, we're not going to give you any more uranium? Then what are they going to do? 98% of their power comes from nuclear. That's a problem, you know? So anyway, the only reason I'm telling you about this is because you're all engineering students, and power in the future is going to be a bigger issue, and really it's important that you have a balance between different sources. But what's nice about the AC generator is it doesn't matter what source you use. All you need to do is turn the wheel. Now, some of you actually have an AC generator at home and you might not even know it. Can you think of anything you have where you turn a wheel and you get power? Yes, bicycle. The light on the bicycle is an AC generator because you click it onto the wheel. And as the wheel turns, you make a small power for the light.
No, even that also has an electric battery. Right.
Yeah.
Nice.
So you can cycle and you can make some power for your TV or whatever.
No. So I can drive it like a motorbike.
Oh, you can charge it.
Charge it.
Ah, very good. Very good. So then when you go uphill, you can get a boost.
Yeah.
And then when you go downhill, you can charge it up.
Yeah,
okay, nice. Now, in the exam, they will ask you to draw the AC generator. So before I give you some notes on it, can you try your best to draw this in your book, please?
Can you draw it?
Yes, I can. Can you?
Okay, so...
make that in your notebook. Can you draw for one? Of course you can. You're good at drawing. You're an expert. The black at the front? It's just a resistor. So for example one, if a huh? Oh, because you're generating power for something. So for example, if it was a bicycle, then the resistor would be a light. If it was a power plant, then the resistor would be everybody's home. Yeah, but technically anything you connect to the circuit, like a lamp, reduces the current because you're using the power to do some work. So a resistor isn't only just the small cylinders, it's anything that reduces the voltage by consuming it. They are just called slip rings. It's a difficult picture right now. Did you draw it yourself? Oh, this word, slip ring, brush, magnet, generator. Huh? What word? It does not. Yusuf, did you draw this? Show me your work of art. Abstract art. You look tired today. Not enough sleep this week, huh? Saturday morning, sleep until 12? Do you share? Your house?
Yes.
And are they noisy people in the morning? Oh, so you could sleep uninterrupted. Nice, okay. Huh? Does it? Yeah, gets in the way of the sleep. Yeah. No, I get that.
What's
slight hip. Slip ring. Slip ring is just a ring. It's a ring that the brush touches. So here's the brush, and here's the ring. And the ring turns on the brush. So this is called a slip ring. This is called a brush. Yeah, it's called a split ring, because it's like this. But these ones are full loops. The reason for the difference is because if you had, well, it'll become clear in a moment when I do the graph, but if you have a slip ring, then you're, when I draw the graph, it will become clearer, but you don't want these swapping places, which is what would happen if they're a slip ring. Yeah, slip rings means when it turns upside down, they've swapped places. I suppose, yeah, technically you could use the split rings. It's just not usually done. But it would still work to use the split rings. Okay, can I continue now, please?
Is this thing that's turning a magnet too?
No, just the conductor. Yeah. So,
which is like when it gets to the south and becomes
north? No, well.
Yeah.
Okay, so according to Faraday, we have this formula, right? This is Faraday's law. Now, remember we have for the moment, let's just forget about the minus n. The minus tells us the direction, which I don't care about right now, and the n tells us the number of loops. But let's just make it easy and let's say there's only one loop here. Okay? So do you remember that the formula for flux is BA? Now if you look at this conductor, which is changing? The B or the A?
B.
Yeah, because the area is staying the same. Anyways, how does the BA change? Well, we have a formula. You remember for flux, if there's an angle theta. So if you look back at it, I think, was it a cos or was it a sine theta?
Which one?
The one with the BA in it for the flux.
Sine.
Okay. So it's a sine theta. So we have, we need to add in a, oh, is it a sine or is it a cos? It's a cos theta to the BA. Yeah, MBA one, yeah, cos theta, yeah. Now, this is like the full formula. You see, we don't use this form, well, okay. We replace the flux with BA, but that's wrong because we're at an angle. Let's say the angle is theta, then we should replace BA with BA cos theta. Now, how is this changing? It's changing because the angle is changing. How does cos change? In other words, what is the derivative of cos? What is the rate of change of cos? You know this.
Minus sine.
Very good. And if I don't care about the minus for the moment, then just sine. So in other words, we end up with a sine graph. So what's going to happen here is if we graph this, where here is theta, and here is voltage. At the very beginning, if theta is 0, then sine theta is, what's sine 0? 0. And as theta increases, what happens to sine? Increases. But then? Decreases. So the graph looks exactly like this. So the voltage would increase to a maximum and then decrease to the minimum. Although it's the same, just in the other direction. This is what's happening here. The voltage increases, but then it decreases and goes backwards, the current. So these here are like this, from the power plant. Current gets bigger, smaller, backwards. Do you understand? Exactly, the current is changing directions. Current comes out, current goes in. Going back and forth like this. Yeah. In fact, I can also tell you for this, in the power plant in Ireland, it uses a frequency of 50 hertz. What does 50 hertz mean?
Per second
what? Like, 50 cycles. So it means each second the current comes in, comes out, and goes in 50 times in 1 second. Yeah? Well, we'll get the voltage now in a moment. What voltage is this? No, what's it in Ireland? In Ireland it is not. 220. Yes, I thought you said 120, sorry, 220. Now, does anybody know where on the graph that is? Because it's constantly changing. The voltage gets bigger and the voltage gets smaller. So where do you think the 220 is on the graph? Yeah, you maybe think it means 220 here and 220 here. Yeah?
No?
Okay. What then?
220 is the total.
The total? Oh, so this is like 110 and this is minus 110.
No, per second?
Hmm? What do you think, Yusuf?
I think it's like a small portion of the whole voltage that comes out for a graph. So it's like, I don't know, like, the top is 2,200 or something like that.
Oh, okay. You want me to go really big up here, is it?
Yeah,
like this or something?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. No, too big. Too big. 220 volts means the average coming out is 220. But where is the average on this graph? Well, most people might think, okay, if that's 220, then maybe they mean this is 440, and 220 means sort of the average here. Actually, it's not. This top value here is 220 multiplied by root 2. Now, it's a bit weird, but if I say this graph has an average value of 220, it means the peak is 220 times root 2. And I can't tell you why. I mean, I can't tell you why, but we don't do enough maths on IFY to explain why the average here is 220 times root 2. But what I can tell you is if you had this graph, and this here is 220 root 2, and if you randomly pick values like what you did in the coursework, so you pick random values, so you have all these random values, some of them are positive, some of them are negative, of course, like this one here is negative. If you make them all positive by getting the absolute and then average them, you will discover the average is 220. So when you have these types of graphs, the maximum will be always the average times root 2. And there is a mathematical reason for this which you can't know yet. You're too young to know it. Okay? But you do need to know this fact for the exam. So the voltage at the maximum equals root 2 times the voltage, which is the average. So for the exam, they like you to know this. And also, if you can draw the graph as well, please. So if you can draw this graph, where this is time, and this here is voltage. Whoa. Like this. Huh? Yeah, please. Actually, I might have a nice graph here. Oh yeah, look, there it is there. So we start off with the conductor vertical at 0 degrees, and then we rotate it, and as we rotate it, we get the voltage here. They also want this on the graph as well in the exam. They want the position of the conductor. So if you can put this underneath your graph as well, please. To what? To this? Oh, the formula. Yeah. Okay, can I go back to the... Yeah. You enjoyed this sentence? No, you got that.
What are those?
Isn't that an internet meme? What are those?
Yeah.
Is it?
What are those?
Those are the conductors in their different positions. So when the conductor in back here, you see that thing that's spinning? It usually begins its life in the vertical position, and as it rotates, it makes the voltage as shown. So if you see here, when is the voltage at the maximum? When the conductor has become a horizontal. Yeah? It does. In this picture here, which way is it being turned? Clockwise or anti-clockwise? I suppose you can't really tell. Can anyone tell? Probably clockwise, actually. I'm sorry, actually, I don't know. I never thought about it before. I think it is clockwise, though. Just upside down. Anyways, it doesn't really matter because in the exam, you know, this is fine. You have this? Continue? Okay. Okay, we talked about it. So, the reason this is called AC is because AC stands for alternating current. So what do you think alternating current means? If your English is good, which it is. Yeah. So AC current is a current which flows that periodically reverses direction. And what's DC current? Direct current. The flow of electric charge is only in one direction. Continue. Great. Finally, do we have a handy way to figure out which way the induced current will flow? Yes we do. So this is Fleming's right-hand rule, not to mix it up with the left-hand rule. So it's the right-hand rule. Yeah, just different hand. So this motion is how you turn the wheel. This field is the magnetic field, and this is the current that you get. So if I go back to my picture here, so in this picture here, let's look at the left. So if I'm turning this wheel, which way am I turning it?
This way.
Yeah. Which direction is the force here at this side of the wheel? Up. So up. Which direction is the magnetic field? Into the page?
Magnetic.
That way. So which way is the current going? In the page. And you can see in the picture it is going in the page.
Wait, but which side are we looking at?
The left. Where are we standing?
Can you point at it? The blue one.
Now over to the right. So over here, which way am I turning the wheel? I'm turning it this way. So which way is the force?
Downward.
And the magnetic field? It's still going to the right, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the current?
Coming out.
Which it is.
This is going to be a very, very good idea.
Yeah. Yeah, we can practice now our song and dance moves at the end of the year. Fleming's right hand rule. Okay, enough weirdness. So that is Fleming's right-hand rule. Please draw. I realise there's a lot in this lesson because we're still not finished it yet. What's so funny? What happened to that poor hand? There was a birth defect or something.
I got A in art in high school.
Did you really? Conceptual art, wasn't it? Yeah, it's for the viewer to decide what it is. Omar, did you draw this hand?
Yeah.
Show me. Okay, you all drew that? Yusuf, you have that? Yep. Okay, note please, normally when the flux is changing, either the B or the A changes. So if you recall, flux equals BA, so the change in flux will be this minus this, the end minus the start. However, usually for us, only one of these changes. So for example, it could be like this, Or maybe it could be like this. You get what I'm saying? This is good news because it makes our problems a little easier. So we either have A times the change in B or B times the change in A. The change in B is if the B changes, and then the change in A is if the area changes. Which do you think we normally have? It's usually the B changes, because usually the magnet gets stronger or then it gets weaker. But actually, the change in A, what does that mean? How do you change the area? Not coil. Like if I have a magnet here, well, that wouldn't change the area. Let's say we have a conductor here. No, not that. Good try though. Let's say we have a conductor here. Well, if I move this conductor, then the change in area is the area in the space you make as you move the conductor. So for example, if this is my conductor, you see here, and if I do this, then the change in area is how quickly I'm making the area. Like, think about this. Delta A over delta T times B. Just look at this part. What unit is this? Meter squared per second. So you think about what that means. That means how many meters squared I make per second. So if I have a meter stick and I move it 1 meter in 1 second, then that's 1 meter squared per second. Do you understand? Yeah? Or, I'm not sure. You look like you understand, but I don't know if you're tricking me. You understand?
Yeah.
Because you're thinking, we say we don't understand, he's going to keep us here longer talking.
I have nothing to do for the rest of the
time. Oh, okay, right. You all understand, yeah? Really? Okay. Imagine this is 1 meter. Okay? And if I move this up 1 meter, what area do I have? 1 meter squared. Let's say I move it up 2 meters in a second, what area do I have? 2 meters squared. So in the first case I have 1 meter squared per second, in the second case I have 2 meters squared per second. So that means this will be 1 or it will be 2 in those examples.
So what can the conductor and the generator
do? Yeah, how can you do that? Because it's fixed, exactly. In what situation could you move the conductor in space but still have it moving inside the magnetic field? You would need a really big magnetic field. Do you know any really big magnetic fields?
Earth.
Yeah, Earth. So these situations only happen when you are in like a room like this. And if I drop this onto the ground, I actually can get a voltage across it. Now the voltage will be really, really small because the B for Earth is really, really small. But if I could connect a little voltmeter here and here on a conductor and then drop it in this room, this is moving in the magnetic field, it will make a small voltage run across this.
Legit.
Now when I say small voltage, I really do mean like microvolts.
Yeah, microvolts.
Legit.
What about the electrical thing? Does that have anything
with... No, that's different. Yeah. And actually one of the questions for the homework is to calculate the voltage across an airplane. Because if you think about it, an airplane is a very big conductor moving very fast. So actually, that's big enough that you can easily measure it. You'll get something like 1 volt across the wings. So if you could connect a light to the plane, you'd actually get a little 1 volt light bulb if you wanted to. Now this isn't the best way to make power, because, you know, planes use a lot of fuel, but it gives you the same idea. You can make power by moving a conductor in a magnetic field.
Even if you
move it, yeah, as long as it's moving. Yeah. Okay, now, I did draw that. So we have questions to do, but I think what we'll do is we have one, two questions, and then we have five examples. I think we'll make the two questions and the five examples a tutorial and do all seven in the next class. It wouldn't kill you if you wanted to try some of them yourself. I don't think it would kill you. I've never heard of this happening, so. All right. Next week, I may run an extra physics class for the next couple of weeks just to speed things along.
You can take